Good day, friends. Welcome to Gord's Poetry Show. I think we're up to number 35, although I could be out one way or the other. Maybe it's 36, maybe it's 34. But that's purely archival matter. It's September something or other, 2014. And the world is definitely going to hell in a handcart. No question about that. But when has it ever been doing anything else? And, of course, poetry lives to tell the tale. Always has, always will. And it's going to tell a few tales today, after I have a little sip of water. And we're going way back. Francois Villon, perhaps the most celebrated of French medieval poets, died in, I think, 1463. We're not exactly sure. May have died the year before. But I'm sure he's happy in eternity now. And being French, of course, we have a translator. A new translation by Anthony Mortimer. And this is very definitely a new book. And I came across a poem that I thought was very timely. Poems have a habit of being timely. But as they get older, they're not quite so timely. Usually because their mode of expression is, well, antiquated. But not always. And of course, I've now lost the poem I was going to read. How is that possible? Well, I guess anything's possible. The Ballad of Proverbs. The more the goat scratches, the less well she lies. The more the pot's filled, the more surely it cracks. The more iron's heated, the brighter it glows. The more that it's worked on, the sooner it breaks. The more a man's worthy, the more he is praised. The more he's away, the less spoken his name. The more he seeks evil, the more he's despised. The more you cry Christmas, the sooner it comes. The more a man chatters, the less sense he makes. The more fame he acquires, the more favor he'll meet. The more that he pledges, the more oaths he breaks. The more you keep asking, more surely you'll get. The more something's costly, the more it is sought. The more common it may be, the lesser its charm. The more you go seeking, the sooner you'll find. The more you cry Christmas, the sooner it comes. The more a song's heard, the less it's forgotten. The more a dog's loved, the more often it's fed. The more a fruit's kept, the more surely it's rotten. The more a fort's battered, the sooner it falls. The more you delay, the more plans will collapse. The more you make haste, the more hopes are undone. The more you embrace, the less matter you clasp. The more you cry Christmas, the sooner it comes. The more you keep joking, the less men will laugh. The more a man spends, the more tattered his shirt. The more that is promised proves less than enough. The more you're free-handed, the more you go short. The more that you give, the more cash you must bottle. The more God is loved, the more churches are crammed. The more the wind turns, the more cold is tomorrow. The more you cry Christmas, the sooner it comes. The more fool lives, Prince, the more he will learn. The more that he travels, the sooner he's home. The more he gets beaten, the wiser he'll turn. The more you cry Christmas, the sooner it comes. I'll remember not to cry Christmas. Peter Unwin, When We Were Old, a Toronto poet and author and teacher. This is very definitely his newest book, 2014, When We Were Old. Union Parent. Every morning I concentrate my fire on the tanks and armored vehicles that attack my family. Before the kids are up, I blow the lid off another tin of tuna. My coffee brews in the aftermath of corporate greed. I command armies of children who have little to lose. They are toothless, but their ability to destroy the enemy is great. The enemy at this moment is reading the news in a voice she believes to be neutral, but in fact is the voice of war. Kapow! I put her attractive nose out of place with a punch. The enemy is fondling my knee beneath the table, involving me in two-for-one deals and discount coupons. At high tea, I join forces with low life and come out swinging. In the time it takes me to spread mayonnaise, the enemy expires on the massage tables of Bahamian resorts, reading books by a Portuguese fabulist. My tent is rainproof. Only the laughter of children penetrates my tent. In the Ganges, I spread peanut butter. In the Everglades, I bake cookies. At Michipocutin River, I put crackers in small Tupperware containers that are not easily detected by police scanners. I am what the state fears most, father of two, skilled at uttering of bedtime stories and making improvised playful devices. I read Gombrowicz to the kids, I command the TV remotes, and have made the snakes and ladders board my kingdom from which I send plasticine anarchists into the world. Plasticine anarchists. Ooh. The envy of artists. When the dining is done and we've put our little party hats on our heads to celebrate so-and-so's latest novel, a book so staggering, you say, we seem to have had a pause there. I will go home and remember something said to me by a painter who is dead now about having the courage to follow our prayers into obscurity. How we have turned art into an endless lunch meeting. You like that book? I don't hate you for it. I will leave that to Guy or Maupassant. After all, your kid and my kid play on the same soccer team, although my kid is clearly better at it than yours. I don't play those games, heavens no. Lives of painters. There was a time you wouldn't know a Modigliani to see one. Now you stand in front of the sad blank almonds that he put in place of eyes and wonder if she survived the Nazis, this servant girl in her somber uniform, painted as if portraiture wasn't dead. Next to her is Thora Klinkkraustrom, a woman obviously well treated by men. You see this in the angular diffidence that comes from wearing fine things. Beside her hangs a sullen nude with a left breast that looks to have been recently sucked. All this beauty, all these nudes, painted in 9 months for an exhibition shut down by the police in half a day. Now you stand in front of Jeanne Helterbrunn, who brought him home without a word when she found him drunk on the street. A pig and a pearl, she called him, but who is not that? In his 35th year, he lay dying of cranial meningitis in a foul room, living entirely on sardines. Jeanne had already climbed to the 6th floor of the tenement and thrown herself to her death. She was 21 years old, the mother of his daughter, pregnant with his second child. Not a happy story. Toronto poet Lorna Goodison published a number of books. Well respected and reviewed. Here's her newest, Supplying Salt and Light. And interesting cultural stuff here, I must say. Of course, I'm terminally white, so you know anything from 2 inches away appeals to me as culturally interesting. we'll start with one of the old dead white guys here. Sintra's Glorious Eden, after Lord Byron. So I remain here in these ruined gardens of the Moorish castle, because I am afraid to scale the heights. I did not ascend with you, my love, to the turret where the cultured, intrepid Moors looked out over Sintra's Glorious Eden. Lord Byron called it so when he stayed at Lawrence's Hotel, where he never slept alone, being the hard Lord Byron. He lauded Sintra's lush beauty. He ate their meat, imbibed their wine. He washed his mouth upon the people, the dead yard school of poetry. Two sphinx cats faced profile with me by the dry wall of the Moorish castle. We triptych under the torn flag flown by the Moors. The sun is going down. Night will come soon to Our Lady's house of woe. Like Byron, I do not sleep alone. Husband, hold me in your arms when you descend. Walk me out of this stone garden. Name me brave. Declare me lovely. A cure. A cure. Not a cure for poetry, but a cure. Drumhead is pounded as medicine to cure madness in my Senegalese friend's village. Diagnosis for disease in the head. Separation from one's life rhythm. So what a good bush doctor will do is this. Summon the drummers in, arrange them in a circle around the one who has lost it. The drums beat out a range of rhythms from console notes coaxed out of female hide to baritone rumble of stretched male skin. The doctor who never sleeps until a cure is effected observes the afflicted one. Notes responds to a certain beat. Doctor urges drummers to concentrate on beat, repeat till patient catches it, opens mouth, swallows, beat enters system. Re-enters bloodstream, pumps through veins and arteries, resets rhythm gone off at pulse points. The entire village joins in a dance with the one who lost but found again their one and only rhythm. Hard cases require drumming for 9 straight days and nights. But all my friends' people have is time. Is that all we have? Time? Or space as well? Some would argue that both are illusions, time and space, and only eternity is real. But we'll get to that another time. James Franco, American actor, director, well known for a number of different things. I'm familiar with his more literary adaptations. He has a fondness for such, and his biopic, if you want to call it that, of Hart Crane is really quite remarkable. The one, the Ginsberg Hull one, is better known, of course. He has a book, a new book, or no, it's a debut poetry book. It's called Directing Herbert White. And surprise, surprise, it reflects on his film experiences. Acting tips. When I played Saul in Pineapple Express, I said, fuck it, acting should be fun. No more twisted, self-centered James Dean demons. There was one thing that was important. Saul should love Dale. That was the secret that made Saul so much more than Harold and Kumar. Then I played Scott Smith, Harvey Milk's lover. I'm still surprised by the response to that character. The secret there? Minimalism. The film is called Milk, not Smith, and that's how I played it. A supporting lover, thus as a supporting actor to support Sean, whom I love so much. In Howell I played Ginsberg, and I was all alone. My scenes were speeches given to an unseen interviewer. Like Shirley Clarke's portrait of Jason. All I did was get down Alan's cadence by listening to him read Howell over and over again, all the versions over the course of 40 years. So many recordings. He wrote the poem, and then the poem wrote him. In 127 hours, I knew the key would be show, don't tell, because the character just does. I knew the audience would have an experience because I wouldn't be telling them how I feel. I'd be feeling. And when the character does talk, he does it to his little video camera. I look right into the lens, ostensibly talking to my family and friends, but I'm looking right at the audience. So it's like a Shakespearean aside without breaking the fourth wall. And I talk about my feelings in the most intimate way. It's like I'm talking to the people in the theater as if they're all my friends, and I'm telling them everything there is to know about me. I think I saw about half of those films. He's got a series of film sonnets, perhaps not surprisingly. Everyone seems to want to write a sonnet these days. I'm surprised Prime Minister Harper and Obama don't write them too. Maybe they will, you never know. Maybe Hillary Clinton will write one. Hillary Clinton's sonnets, wouldn't that be great? the State Department and iambic pentameters, oh god. Film Sonnet 4. Wonderful whore, Deneuve. To flow from the Polanski madness to umbrellas to the housewife with a penchant for sex. And in that one I could watch the John with the sword cane 5 million times, his black hair and iron teeth. Good casting, Benuel, Pierre Clementi. Later he worked with Bertolucci on the adaptation of Dostoevsky's The Double. He's also in a little flashback in The Conformist. In Belle de Jour, there's a shot of him and Deneuve that starts out on their faces as they make out on the bed. Then the camera pans over their horizontal legs to their feet, at which point Pierre pushes the toe of one wicked black boot against the heel of the other, and the boot drops to the floor to reveal a red sock with a hole at the end, his big toe snailing out. Ah, Ledger. No doubt, Heath. Did I see him in any films at all? I can't even, I don't think so. I've missed him and then he passed away. Jeez. Ledger. I've tried to write about you. I didn't know you. There was the one time I met you in Teddy's, the club connected to the Roosevelt Hotel, the night Prince was playing. Around the time of all the award shows, when you were nominated for everything for Brokeback Mountain. I saw that. And you were with your woman, Michelle, two blondes, quiet and stern, mystical. I wrote a poem about you before, yeah, back when you died, but it was coded and unclear, because I didn't dare write about you openly, because your death had made you holy. Holy in Hollywood. You got it all when you died. You got all the gold statues because you were the Joker with your tongue swirling and your death. There had been a time when we were up for the same roles. 10 Things I Hate About You, based on The Taming of the Shrew, and The Patriot. Funny, you were Australian and so was Mel. You were the knight in A Knight's Tale, although I'm sure you wished you weren't. And then something happened. You played gay and you took off. Imagine that, playing gay and taking off. You were an artist for a moment. Was it too much? Was it the drugs that helped you? The drugs that killed you? Was it the acting? Or was it all of us, outside the screen, just watching? Was it all of us just outside the screen, just watching? I think Germaine Greer once said in one of her essays that Jimi Hendrix died because we didn't love him enough. That was a long time ago, but for some reason I remember it. I think he died because he wanted to go to Jupiter's salt mines. And be a voodoo child. There's a number of Canadian poets and writers live in the small town of Cobourg. And I know about them through their various Facebook posts and updates and whatnot. Here's one I hadn't heard of before. Richard Greene and his new book, Dante's House. Well, it's newish. Not that old. Breakwater in Cobourg. Danger, uneven surface, do not use, a sign strenuously forbids. Wave bruise the cronkite and pull it down sheet by sheet, but it is safe today for middle-aged feet. Out to where the beacon waits for weather and formed up birds pass in first lit water. The grebe and the loon and Canada goose break the glass of early morning. June's great lake, still as if its back were silver, and all things seen twice. The birds dive and cross, their wings reachless and folded as they parade in the first hours of day. Sunlight will wade towards noon, or evening, or the far dark of love, reduced to embers or to spark. But this broken breakwater reaches out of all my 47 years of drought to sunrise. My soul's clock turns around to its beginnings, to its ocean wound and the flights of tern, gull, and guillemot over their sterner waters. The crowned knot, hitch, and bowline of those times holding fast. I wake this day a friend to that strange past, and walk where boats are roped to certainty. Death is the difference you cannot see. Surrender. Autumn stands for surrender. Life in leaf becoming soil and must. Spirits rout where kneeling clouds grayly devout. Praise winter's god who mingles grace and grief. Words stand for gaps in being, the mind's sheaf of things gathered and done. We do without most of what we are. Our nature is doubt. Shaking boughs are the language of belief. Wow. Gary Barwin. Moon Baboon Canoe. And Are you wondering what that could possibly signify? In this new book, edited by Stuart Ross and published by Mansfield? Well, let us go to page 42, where there is indeed a poem called Moon Baboon Canoe. A baboon rents a canoe, then smashes into the moon. Fragments of moon baboon canoe rain down. As you breathe, your lungs fill with moon baboon canoe. Moon baboon canoe. Inside each breath, people who I love. You say people about whom I care. Moon baboon canoe. Moon shoelace canoe. Baboon baboon. That explains it all perfectly, doesn't it? Marvelous bit of explication there, Gary. Congratulations. And if you really want to ask further questions, I understand he's writer in residence at University of Western Ontario. And why don't you just like drive on down there and ask him all kinds of difficult, awkward questions? And now for something completely different from the same poet, Seed Pod Microfiche. Excuse me, I've got a frog in my throat today, sorry about that. A grass blade, a truck, a small sun, a constellation. Evolution is an oblong song. The fishes whisper seed pod. Microfiche of twilight, a dewdrop observed, a cobweb, a weed-wrapped tongue or treetop bulrush. An art song, consciousness, a fossil eight-track of the city. There is, my love, a stethoscope whose end is nowhere, whose earpieces are everywhere. A glimmering blade, a small truck, a grass sun, a constellation of lines. Evolution is a long song, whispering fish. The seed sown is dropped twilight. Microfiche and observation tower for wings. Weeds, a rupture of the tongue, bulrush consciousness, a molecular tower, the roseate backing track to the city. There is love, my love, for a stethoscope, whose rapture is everything. Glass braid of the eclipse, winter makes smaller our small sun, for whom consolation is everything. A song of longing whispered between fish and phone. Seed pod is the nape of springtime on the map of trees. Insert song here. A fossil, an earnest stethoscope, but no end. The last bidding of the lips, a consternation of sun, a long song, paths of fish through the whispers of elevators and seed beds. Seed is the mitosis of sleep, dew on the rabbit, nap of the tongue, twilight braided through an owl injured by song or inured to it. Strangers are fossils, stethoscopes with no eyes. The truck, only four, asks, what else would stars do but constellate? The solution? Whisper like fishes, pause of twilight, microwave cobwebs wrapped like weeds or a rush around the young. An experienced guide can follow A-tracks through the city, the way a scientist follows an atom's breath. Love like a stethoscope, with neither ears nor heartbeats. Glass stuck in the foot, a small revolution, the immolation of whispers, a barbican of fish. Matter grows from light, a cobweb, its own misery. Dusk on the owl of the tongue. A fossil records its own memory. A stethoscope whose end is its beginning, and whose beginning is also twilight. Now there's pure poetry for you. And faced with the abstract patternless madness of the world, what is more appropriate? Goodbye, friends, and more poetry in your life in every moment possible. Please, please, please.